Hello everyone, wherever you are, this is Alex Pascho from Crystal Touch Bell's Palsy Clinic in Rotterdam. Today we are going to speak about Bell's palsy. What is Bell's palsy? This is the question that a lot of people who have been affected by this functional disorder ask themselves immediately after the diagnosis has been established by the doctors. And I have to say that the information on the internet is pretty much controversial and not always consistent. So with this recording, I would like to share with you our vision about what Bell's palsy is and what it is not. In general, Bell's palsy is a particular diagnosis for peripheral facial paralysis. So essentially, the correct name of this functional disorder is a peripheral facial paralysis. And only when the cause of this paralysis cannot be established, then it is considered an idiopathic facial paralysis, which is then gets the name Bell's palsy. Today we are discussing a classical Bell's palsy and not so-called congenital facial palsy, which appears at birth. The topic about that particular kind of facial palsy will be discussed in one of the following recordings. So let's start with the symptoms. What are the symptoms of facial palsy? In our case, it's Bell's palsy, which means that we assume that facial paralysis has the causes which could not be established by your physician, by your neurologist, or your ENT doctor. The symptoms, characteristic for Bell's palsy, acute facial paralysis, peripheral. First, sudden or quickly developing within several hours or at most within 1 or 2 days, paralysis of facial muscles. So the half of the face stops functioning. The eye gets wide open, facial asymmetry at rest is very visible, mouth corner drooping, can be excessive tearing or to the contrary, dry eye, and the face cannot be moved. Once again, these symptoms can develop either within a few hours or within 1 or 2 maximum days. Sometimes the person just wakes up with that already happened. So the first thing is that can also be characteristic for the facial palsy, Bell's palsy in our case, is it can be with or without pain in or behind your ear. Sometimes pain can also affect half of the head or even radiate to the neck and shoulder areas. It is not always the case, but it can be. And if the pain is there, then it is unfortunately not a very good prognostic sign, which means that the inflammation that most probably causes the facial paralysis is quite severe. So then recovery can take quite a considerable time. What are possible causes of facial paralysis? In our case, Bell's palsy. It could be local overcooling. For example, we had a patient who was watching her son doing downhill skiing. She had a very light jacket and had no hat, no scarf. And she had to stay outside in the winter weather for a couple of hours. And then the next morning, she woke up with a facial paralysis. So local overcooling, which means that due to very cold weather, the blood vessels that are supplying the nerve with blood, with oxygen, with all the other necessary substances, become spasmed. And so the blood flow stops. And as we all know, without oxygen, our nervous system or any nerve cell cannot exist for longer than just a few hours. In the case of the facial palsy, facial nerve, it could be a few days. So when that damaging factor has been removed, then the chances for relatively quick recovery are much higher. First, local overcooling, spasm of blood vessels. If the person, due to some external reasons, could be unilateral spasm of blood vessels on one side of the head, and that again will block the oxygen supply to the nerve tissue, and of course, without oxygen, the nerve cannot function properly. It could be also a bacterial infection of the inner ear. When there is otitis media, then when the inflammation can spread out and also involve the facial nerve, which is located, by the way, very close to the ear. It runs here within the mass of the pyramidotemporal bone, so-called. There is a very narrow channel, which has an S shape, and within that channel, the facial nerve is very vulnerable to inflammation and swelling. When the swelling takes place within that narrow channel, the nerve can become constricted and also cease their normal functioning. One of possible causes for facial palsy, it's not a Bell's palsy, it's a facial palsy, it could be Lyme disease. Lyme disease can also lead to facial paralysis. Then it is, again, it's not a Bell's palsy, because as we all know, Bell's palsy is the facial paralysis, peripheral, unilateral, for which the cause cannot be established. As one of other possible causes of facial paralysis could be herpetic infection. In this case, the diagnosis will be Ramsay-Hunt syndrome. Some other more, let's say, remote causes for facial palsy could be surgical interventions, either in the cerebellopontine angle, or could be some local interventions during cosmetic surgeries, for example, where chance is very small, but it happens sometimes that also the facial nerve becomes affected and either the whole nerve or part of it can stop functioning normally. Could be tumors, which usually affect facial nerve allocated within the cerebellopontine angle, which means here in this projection of my finger inside the skull. Traumas, of course, if the person gets traumatized, and that especially the temporal bone gets fractured, then the facial nerve has a fair chance also to be affected. What are the risk factors to develop facial paralysis? By the way, I want to remark that facial paralysis or Bell's palsy, whatever you want to call it for today's recording, is not a disease. It is a functional disorder, because a disease can be called a more generalized process which involves more areas or systems or organs in our body. And in this particular case, only one single nerve becomes affected, and it's rather a functional disorder, more like trauma to the facial nerve than a disease. So what are the risk factors? Stress. Well, everybody knows that stress is no good for your body. And in this particular case, stress is also no good for the risk of developing facial palsy. It doesn't mean that every time when you are stressed, you have a risk of having a facial palsy. No, but stress has been firmly, statistically confirmed to be a risk factor. Look, facial palsy or Bell's palsy is never, almost never, happens due to one single factor. It's always a combination of several factors that happen to be at one time and at one place. Another risk factor is last weeks of pregnancy. It has also been statistically confirmed that women in the last weeks of their pregnancies or just immediately after giving birth are more susceptible to having Bell's palsy. Again, it does not mean that if you are a woman, if you are pregnant, you have a risk of having Bell's palsy. Not statistically, it is not happening very often. It's really seldom that it happens, but the risk is there and statistics confirm that. Also, diabetes and high blood pressure are a more remote, but still considered to be risk factors. By the way, very interesting and very common expectation of the Bell's palsy sufferers is that, okay, it has happened very quickly, that's within a couple of hours, within one day. Also, there is a remedy that will recover and restore the function of my facial nerve, rather just as quickly as it happened. Unfortunately, it's not the case, because due to whatever damaging factor has been, the injury had happened. It's like a broken leg. It doesn't matter how quickly some person has broken the leg. It will take at least 6 weeks of immobilization before the bone can consolidate and the immobilizing equipment can be removed, and the active rehabilitation process can take place. The same thing. So if somebody tells you, there is something that you can do and it will come back immediately, well, I don't think that's realistic. So in any case, the recovery takes certain time. So what happens, what stages follows the facial nerve during its facial paralysis, which starts with what is called conduction block. Essentially, facial nerve is a wire. It's a bundle of wires, like a telephone cable that connects our brain to the facial muscles. Only each wire is just very tiny. It's just nanometers thick. It's called axon. It's a long branch to the nerve cell, which is called neuron or motor neuron in this particular case. It's a long branch that grows from all the way from the brainstem through the skull, through the pyramidal temporal bone, and also through its branch to innervate, that's the name, innervate, to provide nerve signals, our muscles. There are many of nerve fibers or axons within the nerve. They are about various evaluations tell between 7 to 10,000 single nerve fibers that make the facial nerve. Why so much? Because we need to innervate a lot of facial muscles. There are many of them. And each muscle has a lot of muscle fibers. And because our face needs to reflect very rich spectrum of emotions, those muscles have to be able to contract and relax their tiniest parts, which means all those tiny parts of the facial muscles has to receive separate innervation. So that's how it runs. And the wire, as any wire that conducts electrical signal, it needs insulation. Insulation is provided by the living cells. They just wrap themselves around that little nerve fiber. And those cells form so-called myelin sheath. Myelin is a protein which has electrical insulating capacities. And that sheath, or that external insulation, suffers first. So whenever the nerve sustains compression, the myelin sheath suffers first, because each of those little buds that are like on the string, they're hanging on the string, is a living cell. And under the mechanical compression, of course, that little thing cannot survive for long, and it just gives in. And then sufficient number of those myelin sheath cells give in, stop functioning, then we develop a conduction block, which means literally what it says, there is no conduction, no connection of the signals between the brain and the facial muscles. That's conduction block. That's the stage number one after compression. Stage number two is that if the damaging factor persists, then also the nerve fibers suffer as the wires suffer. So what happens? Disconnection. Because on the stage one, there is still connection. The wires, which are within the myelin sheath, they are still there. They are still intact. They are still integral. But on the second stage, when the damaging factor acts longer, then there is a disconnection. There is no more physical connection between the brain and the muscles. And there happens so-called degeneration, which means that the nerve fibers all the way from the site of damage to the facial muscles, they just, well, simply said, die, and the immune system clears up the space, so the remaining part of the fibers, nerve fibers, can regenerate, to grow back, to reconnect to your facial muscle. And that's a long process, because, there were some scientific research that established that the nerve fiber at the best possible conditions can only grow 1 millimeter per day. So if we have to cover the distance from behind the ear all the way to facial muscles, it can take a long time. Now, that's what happens. So it is very important to understand your nerve, as the nerve, the whole thing, does not die. If somebody tells your nerve is dead, don't take it. Yes, the so-called distal part of your facial nerve may be compromised, correct. But the root or the nucleus and so-called proximal part of your facial nerve, which is more or less here, remains active and functional, exactly like a grass. If you move the grass in your garden, it of course you cut what's above the ground, but the root of the grass blade remains in the ground, and within a few weeks, the grass will grow back. It's the same with your facial nerve. So please don't panic. Even if your facial movements don't return for a day, two, or even a week or 2 weeks, doesn't matter. The work, the regeneration work is underway. It is very, very, very important to understand, and do not panic, don't despair, and so on. And as I mentioned in one of my other videos on the website, there are two possible scenarios of recovery after facial palsy, in our case, Bell's palsy. If the injury to your facial nerve was only superficial, if the damaging factor has been removed quickly, then the recovery is expected to happen rather soon, within 2 to 4 or 5 weeks, will be complete return of the facial movements without any complications, no residuals, nothing. So if, for example, already after 2 days or 5 days or a week or maybe up to 10 days, you start to see some returning movements or even return of your, let's say, balance of your symmetry of the face in a neutral expression, even if the movements are not coming back yet. But if within a week you see that the face from looking this way start to pull up and to symmetricize, and the eye from going this way goes back to its normal size, then it's a good prognostic sign, and you can reasonably expect that your recovery will be either complete or almost complete. If the damaging factor has been acting on your facial nerve longer than 3-4 maximum days, then the chance is higher that the damage will be more profound and recovery will take longer. It can take from 2 weeks, 3 weeks, all the way up to 3.5 months before the first signs of recovery will appear. Once again, the recovery always, in the case of classical facial palsy, starts with returning of your so-called tone of your facial muscles. So the face does not look lifeless anymore. It shows signs of life, although there are still no movements, but it's not this way all the time. It just gets back to normal symmetry sizes. The eye gets again back to close to its normal size. And then after that, the facial movements will start slowly, slowly to return. In the latter case, when they have a longer recovery scenario, there is a fair chance for residuals and complications, which are have different manifestations, could be facial asymmetry, could be some increased tone of the facial muscles, of course, very well known synkinesis. Everybody's afraid of synkinesis, which I don't think we should be. But that is something which we will discuss in the other recording. And this is what I wanted to share with you in this relatively short video. And if you need more information, please don't hesitate to visit our website. If you need personal consultation, personal advice, please register for a video consultation. I will do the consultation with you. You can ask me all your questions. I will try to give you all the answers if I have those. And you take it from there. So thank you very much for listening. Take care of yourself. Stay healthy. Don't panic. Don't despair. The recovery will come. Thank you.